Let's talk now about Apache Flink, which is another tool. It's in fact one of the latest tools available, part of the Apache since 2015. It says it's the fourth generation of big data analytic platforms, so a newer generation than Spark. But of course, Spark evolves as well. Over time, there is now Spark 3 on the horizon, which also comes with new advances. It supports Scala and Java, but has a rapidly growing ecosystem. And of course, there's a lot of similarities to other big data tools like Spark. In contrast to Spark, it has now here one concept for batch processing and streaming by having a core that is basically built on top of distributed streaming data flow processing. So it's very easy, of course, on top of distributed streaming, well, to have stream processing implemented. But also you can layer on top batch processing abilities like we've seen with Spark, which is then the dataset API. It can use YARN, for example, but also works in local mode. In contrast to Spark, you can perform some iterative computation. So that means you can work on data repeatedly, some operations, until you have basically a result or you meet a condition. In Spark, that is not possible. You have a fixed data flow that has to be performed in terms of stages. It has an interesting semantics called event time semantics that you will find in the appendix because there's no time to talk about it. The programming model of Flink is basically allows you to specify a tag applying transformation. Here we see such a streaming data flow. So we have a source, we apply map, then we want to group the data by a key. We create a sliding windows and apply a function over those sliding windows. And finally, the data gets driven to a sink. And here you find the respective code, which is pretty much building together this little graph. The input here is a Flink Kafka consumer that produces string data. And then we create basically some statistics here of a statistics class using a specific aggregation function specified by the user, which then gets stored in a rolling sink. So now we can look how this little data flow in a condensed form is parallelized. You could imagine that our Kafka source has many concurrent processes because it's a large scale cluster with many, it generates a lot of data. So we can have multiple inputs. And each of these inputs, we run the map function. Then now we want to group the data, which requires some kind of shuffling process here. Apply this window function that we have specified. And lastly, the data gets communicated to our sinks. In this case, we have one sink that then stores the data. So we have basically here one-to-one streams that preserve the order and a redistribution that changes the order of the processing. So the execution is very similar to Spark. We have a Flink program with the code that is linked to the Flink library and such and tools, which come with this optimizer for the data flow graphs, which then represents the client talking to our YARN application job manager. And YARN schedules workers, which are executing the Flink workers for the streaming, providing task slots where we schedule the individual tasks. But this is hidden pretty much from the user. So Flink has a couple of optimizations. Firstly, let me talk about the data plane optimizer and visualizer of the execution plan, which is really useful to understand what's going on. So you can connect to the user interface via a web browser, and there you will find your data flow graph, your DAG. Here we see an example, but also we get some detail what's going on in terms of how it works. And we can also get basically this optimized version of our execution plan, which might be look slightly different than our initial plan. Okay, Flink allows you to chain operations together. So for example, from the data source, we run these filter operations. So it might be useful to combine them on the same node because filtering hopefully reduces the data volume significantly, so it's good to run them on the same node, maybe inside the same execution environment even, same for those two and those two. Likewise, we have here a map operation in these two cases that could potentially be chained together. Lastly, there is a back pressure mechanism. So what is back pressure meaning? So sometimes the source delivers data faster than it can be consumed somewhere in the graph. If that happens, you have the problem that these processes will keep pushing data rapidly into the memory of this process that needs to consume it, but is not able to process the data quickly enough. So to avoid that the memory at some point gets really crowded and you have basically a memory bound, you have this backbreaker mechanism. So that means that this process, if the memory gets too much memory gets occupied by incoming data, can stall these incoming nodes and delay them, which in turn delays these data generators. Of course, if this is live data, you have a problem if a sync cannot keep up with the space. What you need to do typically is then to increase the level of parallelism to make sure that everything works at the rate of data generation.